I welcome all the delegates, chief guests, guest of honors, and the speaker of the today's session, and all the members who are joined from the entire Andhra Pradesh and also from the entire India. So I welcome all once again, and now we stand for the ICAI motto song.
येष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति कामं 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 कामंशो पुरुषो निर्मिमाणः निर्मिमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रद्ब्रह्म तदेवामृतमुच्यते तस्मिन् लोकः अस्मिन् लोकः शतः सर्वे तदूनाद्यति कश्चन
Thank you, sir. Now I request Ongole branch chairman to give his welcome speech.
Good evening, all of you. Today's chief guest, respected CAD Prasanna Kumar garu. Today's speaker, CA Pramod Jain garu, Central Council member, guest of honors, CAT Chinmasthan garu, CA Changal Reddy garu, Regional Council members, and ex officio of Guntur, Nellore, and Ongole branches.
Forget about the payment, you are.
CA J. Srinivasrao garu, chairman of Guntur branch. CA Sujit Jain garu, chairman of Nellore branch. Managing committee members of the Ongole, Guntur and Nellore branches. Past chairmen of all the three branches. Moderator Trivay Kumar garu, senior members of the profession. Young members, students, my professional colleagues. A very good evening to all of you. And on behalf of Ongole, Guntur and Nellore branches of SIRs of ICAI, a very warm welcome to the today's CPE seminar on commonly found non-compliances, errors in Form 3CA, 3CB, 3CD of the Tax Audit Report under Section 44AB of the Income Tax Act. When I was attending a SIRs seminar at Cochin, our Central Council member, CA Prasanna Kumar garu, has conducted a meeting with all the MC members of the Andhra Pradesh branches. And in the meeting, he has advised and encouraged us to conduct joint programs with other parts, other branches of the AP. With the encouragement and support given by our Prasanna sir, we have initiated this seminar as a joint program with Guntur and Nellore branches. I congratulated my good friends, CA J. Srinivasrao and CA Sujit Jain, for immediately accepting our proposal to conduct a joint program on this very important subject, that is tax audits. First time in the history of Ongole branch, we are organizing a joint program with two other branches, two from a Central Council member from the North India. I request all the members to give a big applause for making this seminar a memorable one. The government has recognized the importance of chartered accountants, and in the year 1984, the Income Tax Department has introduced tax audits in the statute book. Since then, all our members are discharging tax audits with a lot of passion and care. For chartered accountants, particularly practicing in mafshil areas, the major work comes from tax audits, and major source of income also comes from tax audits. Over a period of time, there are many changes in the tax audit reports, and due to change in IT law, changes in forms also. In view of the importance of the tax audits, in 2017, ICAI Council has launched the Taxation Audits Review Board, for which CA Pramod Jain sir is the chairman. Now the Taxation Audits Review Board has reviewed many tax audit reports and found some interesting observations. They have prepared a report on some common errors done by the chartered accountants in tax audit reports. In view of the special emphasis given by the ICAI on improvement of the quality of the tax audits, we have planned this seminar. Today's chief guest, respected CA Prasanna Kumar garu, our beloved Central Council member, chairman of SIRCF ICA for the year 2013-14, vice chairman for committee for members in practice, and also vice chairman for career counseling, a vibrant central council member. Prasanna sir is the main person behind the formation of our Ongole branch. Prasanna sir is a good mentor, and his guidance is invaluable for the running of our Ongole branch. Even though our branch is 7 years old, we are running our branch in a rented premises. I request Prasanna sir and Pramod Jain sir to help us in getting funds for the Ongole branch for having its own premises. Today's speaker, C. Pramod Jain sir, is a central council member, chairman of Taxation Audits Review Board, author, regular speaker in various forums across India. He is a reputed, highly experienced and highly rated faculty and an expert in taxation and company law matters. Pramod Jain sir, I am very happy to inform you that I am a regular reader of your book, Chartered Accountants, Documentation and Compliance for Audits and Reviews. It's a very useful book for our chartered accountants. I also post a lot of queries in your portal, expertpanel.com, in which resolves the doubts of the chartered accountants. I think I am one of the highest contributor of questions to the expertpanel.in. The portal is very useful, sir. It has clarified many of my doubts. Pramod Jain sir is going to deal a lot of interesting issues in tax audits, which are very useful for our members. His suggestions are going to help and keep us safe. Hence, I request the members not to leave the meeting till end. Today's guest of honor, CA T. Chinnamasthan Garu. He is our beloved vice chairman of SIRCF ICA, our branch in Nellore branch ex officio, and a good supporter of all our branch activities. And he is a simple and ever smiling person. Today's one more guest of honor, Changal Reddy Garu, is a regional council member and ex officio of our Guntur branch. He is also an ever smiling person. ICA has published two publications on tax audits. One is guidance note on tax audit, which is very old publication, revised every year, very useful for our members. Similarly, the Taxation Audits Review Board has issued one more publication, checklist for tax audits. Both are very useful. I request the members to make use of the publications of the ICA, which are very useful for discharge of our functions. Members, in the recent past, many of our WhatsApp accounts are hacked. I request all the members to have a special password for WhatsApp and also have a updated antivirus, and do not share OTPs to anyone under any circumstances. Sir, the speaker is going to deal a lot of interesting points which are very useful for us. Dear members, our Ongole branch is going to have two seminars in the coming days. On 13th July, we are going to have a seminar on client management in CA office by a personality development trainer, Mr. Sriram. And we are also going to have one more seminar on 17th July, that is on taxation of securities, that is shares, mutual funds, futures and options, both cash market, speculation, capital gains, all those things. We request all the members to join for those two programs also, which are free. All our Ongole branch videos are uploaded in the YouTube channel. We request the members to subscribe for the channel also. I once again thank you one and all. Jai Hind, Jai ICA.
Now I request today's guest of honor, CA R. Changal Reddy Garu, to deliver his address.
Today's chief guest and the honorable central council member of ICA, vice chairman of committee for members in practice, CAD Prasanna Kumar sir, in his absence here. Another respected central council member and today's speaker, CA Pramod Jain sir, who joined with us, vice chairman of SIRCF ICA and ex officio of Ongole and Nellore branches, and CA Chinnamasthan, Ongole branch chairman CA Rajendra Kumar, Guntur branch chairman J. Srinivas Rao garu, Nellore branch chairman Sujit Kumar, and three branch secretaries Chaitanya Reddy, Raviteja, and Arun Kumar, past chairmen of all the three branches, managing committee of three branches, viewers of the today virtual pro webinar, a pleasant good evening to each one of you, and my warm welcome to the virtual webinar on tax audit and commonly found non-compliance in tax audits, organized by Guntur, Ongole, Nellore branches of SIRCF ICI. I am very happy to share that the three branches joined together to organize the today program. I think the Ongole branch chairman touched all the background of tax audit, when it has started, how it has started, and the other background material, everything. I will not go into deep that one. A proper tax audit definitely ensures that the books of accounting and other records are properly maintained, and it helps to show the income of the taxpayer correctly if we have done properly the tax audit, whether the claims for the deduction are correctly made. And there are a few important points for consideration where we will usually do a few mistakes, like presumptive taxation, applicability of the ICDS, and valuation of inventories, land and building when we have transferred, the consideration whether it has been adopted or assessed properly or not, fixed assets and depreciation, the amounts debited to the profit and loss account, whether it is a capital nature or personal in nature, the amount inadmissible under Section 40A, as well as disallowances deemed income under Section 40A3, the income from other sources are chargeable under the other head also has been clubbed sometimes. These are the commonly non-compliances we used to do. I think today's speaker, CA Pramod Jain sir, who joined with us, who is having rich experience. In fact, he used to take a lot of seminars on tax audits and ICDS and all. Even we invited last year for Guntur branch, but we missed because of his other engagement. Anyway, this time I think joining with Ongole and Nellore, the Ongole, the Guntur also got a benefit. Obviously, thank you very much, sir, for accepting the invitation of Ongole, Guntur and Nellore branches and taking a session on today's tax audit. I think Prasanna sir, definitely he will share what are all the initiatives taken by the ICI. With this, my compliments to all the three branch chairmen for coming together and organizing today's wonderful session on tax audits. Thank you very much. Over to the MOC.
Thank you, Changal Reddy garu. Now I request Nellore branch chairman, Sri C.A.K. Sujit Kumar garu, to present the profile of the today's speaker.
Good evening, members. It gives me immense pleasure to present before you C.A. Pramod Jain, Central Council member and our faculty for the day. I can sense that you all will feel delighted at the end of the session after hearing him today on tax audit and basically the non-compliances or the errors which we do in the tax audit. It is one topic which interests me a lot, and we tried to have these kind of sessions last year, and this year we were supposed to have it, and we are lucky that we got it through the coordination of Ongole branch. We thank the Ongole branch for inviting us to be part of this public program, a big program. Thank you, the managing committee of the Ongole branch. So coming to today's speaker, C.A. Pramod Jain, a commerce graduate from Sri Ram College of Commerce, a fellow member of ICAI, a fellow member of the Institute of Company Secretaries, and also the Cost Accountants of India. He's also an LLB. He has qualified the DISA course. He's also a member of the All India Management Association. He's an insolvency professional, also a qualified the post-qualification course on valuation, and he has also passed the certificate course on CSR of ICAI. He is a Central Council member for the period 2019 to 2022. Apart from being member in more than 25 committees, he is chairman of Committee on International Taxation, Taxation Audit Quality Review Board, Valuation Standards Board, CSR Committee of ICAI. He is Vice Chairman of Committee on MSME and Startup, Women Members Empowerment Committee, Direct Tax Committee, Committee on International Taxation, also a member of the disciplinary committee bench 1 and the nominated member of quality review board for 3 years. He is the conceptualizer of the portal expertspanel.in, which I got to hear today that our Ongole branch chairman heavily contributes to that in questions. We would also like to visit that website and gain knowledge from it. We are happy to know that it has solved professional queries by giving nearly 28,000 answers since its launch in the mid-year 2018. Pramod sir has delivered more than 1,300 lectures and articles on various topics: income tax, corporate laws, LLP, audits, peer review, quality review at more than 200 forums. Senior partner of Mrs. Lunawat and Company, and he is president, founder, convener, and member of various boards, committees, study circles of ICAI, ICSA, and other prestigious bodies and associations. He has authored books on chartered accountants, documentation and compliance for audits and reviews, limited liability partnership, a complete resource book, chartered accountants importance of LLP after Companies Act 2013, to name a few. With this, I introduce before you today's speaker, and I have one announcement to make with all of you. Our branch is conducting a public program on MSME, and we will tomorrow from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. The SARC chairman is the chief guest, and the guest of honor is our vice chairman of SARC, CA T. Chinnamasthan sir. And the speaker would be Gopal Krishna Raju sir, who frequently visits Ongole branch. So I request your support, the Guntur branch members and the Ongole branch members and the other members, as it is a public program. All of you can join and make the program a grand success. Thank you.
Thank you, Sujit Jain Garu. So today's chief guest and also the guest of honor will join anytime. So we will start our technical session now. Now I request the today's speaker, Pramod Jain Garu, to take up the technical session.
Thank you. Thank you very much. CAR Chengal Reddy ji, the SIRC member, my three chairmen of the branches, CA K. Rajinder Prasad ji, CA J. Srinivasan Rao ji, and CA Jagan Mohan Rao ji. He is the treasurer, and Sujit Kumar Jain ji. In fact, Rajinder Prasad ji from Ongole, we have been in touch since, I suppose, past quite a few years, over phone, WhatsApp, and then yes, what he talked about, experts panel. And I thank Rajinder Prasad ji for inviting me to share my views on a topic which is, yes, very near and dear to both of our heart as well as pockets. In essentia, the guest of honor, Chinnamasthanji, and my very dear friend, CA D. Prasanna Kumar, my council colleague, we both are serving our first term in the council. And I congratulate each of you who are present here for selecting such a person, Prasanna Kumarji, and sending him to the council. You know, if I just tell you about a thing about the institute has certain standing committees and certain non-standing committees. What you hear about the committee for members in practice or accounting standard board or even direct tax committee or international tax committee or taxation audit quality review board, corporate law committee, these all are non-standing. The standing committees are given in the act, the CA Act, which is an act of parliament. The standing committees, three standing committees, which are the finance committee, the examination committee, and the executive committee. And any person, any council member who is a member of any of these standing committees, he cannot be the chairman of a non-standing committee. So normally it is like a contribution by a council member to the core areas of the standing committees, and he sacrifices the chairmanship of a non-standing committee. And Prasanna Kumar ji is so humble out there that for all the 3 years, he has been into the standing committee. He is the member of the standing committee, all the three standing committees, examination, finance, and the executive, for all the 3 years, he had never taken any chairmanship of any non-standing committee. So that is really a remarkable thing, which I appreciate from the core of my heart. And also continuously 2 years, you know, our disciplinary mechanism, the board of discipline, he is the chairperson, he is the presiding officer of the board of discipline, which takes care of the disciplinary action on the members related to the schedule one part, the part one, schedule one. So he has been contributing to the institute to a great extent. And of course, he's the vice chairman of CMP, of career counseling and other committees. But yes, doing a great job. And my congratulations to each and every member from the SIRC for sending such a member to the institute. Going straight forward for the topic, I'll be talking about the topic and we'll be discussing. So my humble request out here would be that in certain cases, I would be asking certain questions. And in certain cases, you would be asking questions. So if I ask a question, you please reply in the chat box. And if you ask a question, I'll see in the chat box and then I'll reply on the screen, verbally, right? So I'm sharing my presentation and let us go straight to the topic. I'm sharing my screen for that matter. Huh? Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Great. So let us talk straightforward about the tax audit, the legislation for the tax audit. You know, sometimes we get a query that I have done audit under section 44AD or 44ADA or 44AE. You know, when we talk about audit, the tax audit we are talking about, though any audit under income tax is a tax audit. But when we're talking about 3CA, 3CB, 3CD, for that there is one and only one section, that is section 44A. We no other section, please. So whenever you are in doubt whether the audit is required or not, please just refer to section 44AB. The five clauses thereof. And if that entity, that person is covered under any of these five clauses, then the audit would be required under section 44AB. Then you have to see which forms are to be given, which are given in rule 6G. And then there is, you have to decide whether form 3CA you have to issue or form 3CB you have to issue. And annexure to both these forms is in form 3CD. And non-compliance penalty, of course, under 271B. So what are these five clauses? What are these five clauses? These five clauses, if I talk about in a summary way, in case the sales turnover of gross receipt of an SSE from a business exceeds 1 crore rupees. Last year it was 5 crore, now it is 10 crores for assessment year 2021. In that case, the audit would be under section 44ABA. In case of a specified profession, in case of a profession where the gross receipt exceeds 50 lakhs, then the audit would be due to section 44ABB. In case there is a business income in the nature of 44AE, double B or triple B, and the income which is declared is, because these three are the presumptive taxation, and the income which is declared is less than the deemed profits, then the audit would be under section 44ABC. 44AE, we know that it is for the goods carriage vehicle. Heavy goods carriage vehicle, which are more than 12 metric ton, and below that it is 7,500 rupees per month per truck, and above that is 1,000 rupees per metric ton per month on the vehicle weight or the unladen weight, as the case may be. In case of specified profession, which is covered under 44ADA, if the profits are declared and the gross receipts are below 50 lakhs, because above 50 lakhs, it is covered under 44ABB, but below 50 lakhs and the deemed profit is less than 50%, and the total income is more than the maximum amount not chargeable to tax, then the audit under Section 44ABD. And of course, in the case of business, which is covered under 4484, and the total income is exceeding the maximum amount not chargeable to tax, then the audit under Section 44ABE. If I talk about the presumptive income, CDE, the three clauses are there. 44ABCDE. The difference between clause C and D and E. The difference is that for clause C to be applicable, only one condition is to be satisfied, that my income is less than the deemed profits. If you are declaring less than the deemed profits, audit is required. In case of D or E, two conditions have to be set. First, less than the deemed profits, and second, the total income is exceeding the maximum amount not chargeable to tax. A very few professionals are of the view that in this amount of maximum amount not chargeable to tax is 5 lakh rupees. But no, in case of individual HF, it is 2,50,000 rupees. 2,50,000 rupees. And in case of senior citizen, it is 3 lakh rupees. In case of very senior citizen, it is 5 lakh rupees. So that is the limits. Now, if you are covered under any of these five clauses, then you have to see, okay, which form is to be issued. Then it is given in Rule 6G. And then you have to issue the form 3CA and 3CB. My first question here, in which case we have to issue form 3CA? Please type your answer in the chat box. In which case we have to? Sujit Jain Singh, TCS Companies. Any other view? Shivashankar Reddy is saying covered under any other audit under 3CA, another TCB. TCA audit under any other act, Sujit Jain is saying books of account not audited under any other act. Audit under any other act, Rajendra Prasad is saying. Yes. So, okay. More or less everyone is correct. Let me ask a second question out here. Suppose there is a private limited company which is incorporated on 1st of February 2021. And this 2 months, its turnover is 15 crores. So tax audit is required. So in this case of a private limited company, which form you'll issue, 3CA or 3CB? So everyone is saying 3CA. Answer of everyone is 3CA. Okay. Shiva Patwari ji is saying 3CB. All other 3CA. And in my questions, there are no ifs and buts. No ifs and buts. These are the facts. These are the facts. And please understand, only a chartered accountant in practice can do an audit of a financial statement. And he should know the law. He should know the law. Only he can do the audit, no one else. So he should know the law. So most of the persons are saying 3CA. Only Patwari ji is saying Shiva Patwari ji is 3CB. Why Shiva ji? Why 3CB? It is a private limited company. So why 3CB? Our basic purpose is to understand the concept, clarification of the concepts. So why 3CB? It is a private limited company. You know, the answer, correct answer is, of course, 3C, mandatory not to audit. Turnover less than tax audit limit. Sir, I'm saying 15 crore turnover. Venkataji, 15 crore turnover, what is the issue? Rao Saab saying as audit is conducted under Companies Act, hence CCA. Under Companies Act, mandatory not to audit. The answer is 3CB. Why? Why? Because under the Companies Act 2013, if a company is incorporated after 1st of January, then as per the Companies Act, it is mandatory
in December
financial year that the financial year shall end on the 31st March next year. Mandatory, it is not optional. Unlike in 1956 Act, where it was optional. In 2013 Act, it is mandatory. So under Companies Act, there is no audit. We all know, we just read that 3CAs to be issued when there is an audit under the Companies Act, but there was no audit. There cannot be any audit. You cannot do audit under the Companies Act because the financial year is mandatorily ending 31st March next year. Hence, 3CB for March 21. For March 22, whether it would be 3CA or 3CB. For March 22, whether it would be 3CA or 3CB. Sujit Jain is saying 3CA. Rajinder Prasad is also saying 3CA. Shiva Shankar Reddy is also saying 3CA. Lakshmi Reddy is also saying 3CA. So everyone, Surya Pawan Kumar is also 3CA. What is a tax audit basically? For what period? You know, when we file an ITR, for that period, whether the financial statements are audited under any other law. Under the Companies Act, the audit is done after 14 months. For March 22. So how it can be 3CA? Because for the 12 months, there is no audit under any other law. I cannot say attach 14 months balance sheet and tell to the government, okay, proportionate it. No. So for March 22 also 3CB. 3CB. And in March 22, there would be two audits. One under the Companies Act for 14 months. And one under the Income Tax Act for 12 months. So two audits, two fees. Right? We need to be very, very careful in understanding the very, very thing basics. My next question. There is a limited liability partnership. Tax audit is required. You'll issue 3CA or 3CB. It is a partnership, limited liability partnership, not a company. So 3CA or 3CB. Sujit Jain ji, Gokul ji, both are saying 3CA. Rao Sab is saying 3CB. Shivarama ji, Raghavendra Kumar ji saying 3CA. Vamsi Krishna ji saying 3CA. Sojanya Tudu ji is saying 3CB. So few 3CB, maximum are saying 3CA. Srinivasu ji, Hari Krishna ji saying 3CB. Why 3CA? Many members have said 3CA. It is not a company. It is not a private limited or a public limited company. It is a limited liability partnership. LLP, Gokulji, is not covered by Companies Act. There is a separate act, Limited Liabilities Partnership Act 2008. Sujit ji, you are right. Because under the LLP Act, where the turnover is more than 40 lakhs, you have to get it audited under the LLP Act. So understand, you know, when say audit under any other law, so it is not merely Companies Act, it could be LLP Act. So in the case of LLP, whenever there would be a tax audit, it would be a 3CA because there is an audit under the LLP Act also, right? So I have to be very careful. It is not merely about the companies. Now my another question, now under the LLP Act, I have to do the audit. So what is the format of the audit report under the LLP Act? What is the format of the audit report under the LLP Act? No format prescribed. So what you will do? Trivan Kumarji, Societies registered under Societies Act, because under the Societies Registration Act, the audit is required, hence again 3CA. So, Srinivasaluji, if no format prescribed, but you have to issue a report, so what you will issue? Please understand, only a chartered accountant in practice can issue an audit report. No one else. No company secretary, no cost accountant, no advocate, no MBA. Whereas the ICI prescribed audit format. Mamsaji, which ICI guidance note? Srivanju Kumarji, ICI audit format prescribed by ICI for non-corporate audit format. Where is it given? Kaan. Okay, is there any audit report prescribed under the Companies Act for the companies? From where do we get? Under Companies Act, which section? Which section there is an audit report? There is no audit report prescribed under the Companies Act. Please understand. Whenever there is a talk about audit, there is only one and one thing, and Sujit Jainji is very right. It has to be standards on auditing. Standards on auditing issued by ICAI, even for the Companies Act, even those are the standards for LLP, for proprietorship, partnership, everywhere. SS 700 series, 700, 705, 706. You need not look anywhere else. SS 700 series, please. Right? So please take note of that. So now we have understood what do we mean practically that
voice is not audible, sir. Sir, your voice is not audible. Your video is also gone, sir. Pramod, sir.
Prasad, you make a call to the sir. Phone call.
Sir, adana call vasthe agara lekka continue avutunda session manaki
connectivity problem undi.
Sir, your video and audio is not visible, sir. Even screen is also not visible.
Am I audible now?
Audible, yeah. But video is not coming, sir.
It is taking a few seconds.
Yeah. Now you are viewing. We can view, sir.
So I'll share my screen again, right?
Yeah. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Is the screen visible?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I'll repeat this question. It might have missed. Mr. A, he started manufacturing, and in the first year, his turnover, which was all in cash, his turnover was 1 crore 50 lakhs, 150 lakhs, and net profit was 8 lakhs, which was less than 8%. And total income, he filed the return for 8.5 lakhs. So my first question here, can Mr. A, for this manufacturing where his profit is less than 8%, can he avail of Section 44AD? Can he avail of Section 44AD? Sujit Janji says, no, Vansi ji, Praveen ji, Shivaji, everyone says no. Okay. No. Rao Saab, yes, declare 8%. No, my facts are this only. There is no ifs and buts. There is no planning issue. I'm just talking about the concept clear. So what is the reason that he cannot take less, he cannot go for 44AD? Less than 8%. Okay. Cash business. Less than 8%. Second question, is tax audit required under this case? Yes. Yes. So everyone says yes. So let us see the answers and the reasons. Answer is 44AD no and 44AB yes. Why 44AD no? Because the profit is declared less than 8%. If it is manufacturing allowed, it is cash allowed. In 44AD, 100% cash, no issues allowed. But because the profit is less than 8%, he cannot avail of 44AD. And audit, yes, because my turnover is exceeding 1 crore.
And he can declare profit on presumptive basis, even though his book profit is less than is a loss.
But why? I'm saying he is filing his return for 8.5 lakhs.
Oh, okay. He wants to file 8 lakhs.
No. He has filed it. He has to file by 8.5 lakhs only. Why should he pay more tax? So, no. In total discussion of our discussion today, he can no plannings. Our purpose is just to clear the concepts. Clear the concepts. He can do that or not. As per these facts, can he avail of 44AD? The answer is no. The answer is no. He cannot. With these facts. Because the purpose of our session today is to clear the concepts. Had it been more than 8%, he could have surely gone. Right. My second question out here. Miss B, she's a lady doctor who also gives medicines. She trades into medicines. She has taken the GST number for the same. For this trading activity, which is all in cash, her sales is 90 lakhs and the net profit is 10 lakhs, which is more than 8%. Being a doctor, she also receives the professional fee, which is less than 50 lakhs and the net profit is 50%, which is more than 50%. Total income is 32 lakhs. So my first question, can this lady doctor, for her trading activity, where the profit is more than 8%, can she avail of 44AD? Rajesh ji is saying no. Kota Rao Saab also saying no, but Srinivas Rao ji, Shiva ji saying yes. Okay. So many yes. A few no, many yes. Jagan ji is also saying no. My second question, can this lady doctor, for her professional receipt less than 50 lakhs, where the profit is more than 50%, can she avail of 44ADA?
Yes. So majority of the person says yes. Third question. The turnover from the business is 90 lakhs and the professional receipts is 45 lakhs. So together it is exceeding 1 crore. Would the tax audit be required under 44AB in this case? Kotar Rao sir says yes. Shiva Shankar ji Reddy says no. Praveen Kumar ji says no. Rajendra Prasad ji also says no. Sudhi Jain ji says every business has 1 crore. No, no, not required. Not required. Not required. So let us see the answers with the reasons. 44AD no, 44ADA yes, and 44AB no. The reasons. 44AD no, because section 44AD says, it is not the option ki he can take either 44AD or ADA, no. 44AD says that in case a person is having a professional income, in that case, the person cannot avail of 44AD. The section debars. So no 44AD. 44ADA, yes, because there is no restriction out there. There is no restriction out there. And of course, 44AB, no, because it is not covered under any of these clauses. Business, 1 crore, no. Profession, 50 lakhs, no. C, D, E, no, nowhere. So nowhere covered, hence no audit. You have to be covered under any of these five clauses to get itself audited. Otherwise, there is no requirement.
किसके पास जाके कराया वो पूरा
जाके बात करके
इनकम टैक्स ऑफिस
में जाके बात करेगा
कितना लिया
10% ज्यादा कितना जैसे की 11 करोड़ 11 लाख 5 करोड़ 5 लाख
सर प्लीज म्यूट सर
यस ओके
ओके ठीक है कोई नहीं हो जाता नो लेट अस टेक द थर्ड केस हियर मिस सी शी इज ऑल्सो इनटू ट्रेडिंग से ट्रेडिंग इनटू क्लॉथ So when she's trading into cloths in the first year, her total turnover was 80 lakhs, which is in cash. And the net profit is 4 lakhs, which is again less than 8%. And she files her ITR, total income with 3 lakh rupees. So first question, can this lady for her trading activity where the profit is less than 8% avail of 44AD? Can she avail of 44AD? Sujit Jansi says no. Manikanta ji, Shiva Reddy ji, Mantaleshu sir, also everyone says no. Only one yes, maximum says no. Second question. The profit is less than 8%. In this case, is the tax audit required under section 44AB? Is the tax audit required under section 44AB? Sujit ji says yes. Hari Krishna ji says yes. One, two no's. Trivendu Kumar ji says yes. Sandeep ji also says yes. So again, we have got different views. Majority is saying yes. TVB Rao sir also says yes. So let us see. There is nothing called deemed 44AB. The answers, let us see. 44AD no, 44AB no. Why? First, 44AD no, everyone is right that yes, as my profit is less than 8%, I cannot avail of 44AD. Quite fine. Second, why AB no? because I have to be under any of these five clauses. A, not applicable. B, not applicable. C, not applicable. D, not applicable. E, there is a question. E, we have read in our last slide, when would E be applicable? Two conditions to be satisfied. First, to fall within section 44AD4. Second, total income is exceeding maximum amount not chargeable to tax. So this is agreeing, yes, it is 3 lakhs. So yes, this is covered. But is it covered under 44AD4? What does 44AD4 says? 44AD4 says that if a person has ever availed of 44AD earlier, in the earlier years, and then not availed. So the first condition is that the person should have availed 44AD earlier. She has not availed 44AD. So she is not being covered under 44AD4. So when she is not covered under 44AD4, she is out. So she is not covered under 44AD4, no audit under 44ABE. And this change is there since assessment year 2017-18. If any doubt, kindly read section 44AD4 again. Any doubts on this, please? Because this is one of the questions which is any point. Right. Now, the last question in this series. Mr. D, he is also into trading, say trading of yarn. And his turnover is in cash 95 lakhs. And from the yarn, he's also on commission income of 6 lakh rupees. The net profit is 15 lakhs. So the profit from the trading activity is more than 8%. Total income is 14 lakhs. So my question, can Mr. D for this trading activity, where the profit is more than 8%, can he avail of section 44AD? Can he avail of section 44AD? Jain sahab lunga wo bhi lo. Few yes, many no's, but yes, few yes. Okay, so different views. And I always appreciate the different views, because when there are different views, then we need to discuss. Second question, would there be tax audit in this case under section 44AB? No, Rajeshi says yes. So many no's, a few yes. So again, difference of opinion, different views. So let us see the answers as well as the reasons. Answers 44AD, no. 44AB, yes. Why? Section 44AD says that in case a person is earning a commission income, that person is not allowed 44AD. So no 44AD. Person is not allowed. You cannot show the commission in other sources and they said, okay. Even there is an LIC commission of 1,000 rupees. That person is debarred from 44AD. The section says it. The section says it. 44AB, yes. Why? Because now his gross receipt is exceeding 1 crore from the business. 95 plus 6, 1.01 crore. Gross receipt is exceeding. Right? So let us understand the 44AD essentials. 44AD essentials, that the person should be an eligible assessee. Who is an eligible assessee? Eligible assessee is an individual HF of a firm except LLP. Sometimes I get a question that in case of a private limited company, you say now it is 10 crore limits, so turnover is 8 crores. If I show profit less than, say, 3%, so audit is required. No, no, no. 44AD is not for companies. It is only for individual HF and firm and not even LLP. And second, that he should not be having any deduction under section 10A, AA, 10B, BA, or chapter 6A, part C, which starts from section 80H onwards. So if there is any deduction under these sections, then also he is not an eligible SSE. He is out. the eligible assessee should be doing the eligible business. So what is that eligible business? He should be doing an eligible business, which is any business except 44A, the goods carriage vehicle. So you must be saying that, Pramod is saying that it should be this profession commission. It is not mentioned out there. But yes, 44A is restricted and the turnover should be less than 2 crores. If it is exceeding 2 crores, need not see 4%, 5%, 8% profit, hardly matters, even if it is 1% or loss, hardly matters. So my condition in case of only these three, where my turnover is less than 2 crores, then only I will be an eligible assessee doing eligible business. Further, 44AD subsection 6 says that the following persons are not allowed. The section is not applicable to the person. To the person, which we discussed in the last slide, two examples out of which. One is profession under section 44AA1. And second, commission or brokerage. These two examples we have seen. And third is the agency business. Third is the agency business. So two persons having these four types of income, commission, brokerage, profession, and agency business, the section itself is not applicable. It is not about the eligible business. Section itself is not applicable. And please take care. We always talk about the percentage of profit, 8% or 6%. And we say if it is cash, then 8%. If it is by check or NEFT or draft or RTGS and all those, then it is 6%. No. Take care that this 6% is by other than cash, in case the amount of the sales turnover gross receipt is realized within the due date of section 139(1). If the debtors are continuing, the payments are not received, profit has to be 8% or more. Right? And of course, it has to be commensurate with my funds flow. It is not bank account, it is funds flow. It means that suppose, because this question has come also several times, that in my bank, I have deposited, say, 1 crore rupees, that is my turnover. I declare profit at 8 lakh rupees, 8%. No, it is not allowed. Because in this case, if suppose for 100 lakh rupees, you have declared 8 lakhs, so what is this 92 lakhs? If you say it is not from my this business, then this 92 lakhs would be from my undisclosed sources under 69A, taxable at the rate of 78% under 115 BBC. So has to be commensurate with my funds flow. And logically also, if I talk about logically also, I cannot deposit 1 crore and pay tax on 8 lakhs. You know, it cannot be that. Rajesh ji's question is, if it happens to be other source income, other source income is an income which is not covered under any of the other four heads. Commission is specifically into my business income. How can I put that other source? Even if I put it in other source, does that person is having commission income? Yes. So to that person, 44AD is not. Theek hai Rajesh ji. Sandeep ji's question is, what if assessee files 95 lakhs as business turnover and show commission as other source? Again, to that person, 44AD is not applicable. He'll have to file his balance sheet and profit loss, Sandeep ji. This is the law, what I'm talking about. Right? I suppose Kishore ji, you need to mute yourself.
Please mute, sir.
Or any host, host can also yes, go to that person and mute.
Yeah, him, right? I muted, sir.
Sujit Jain ji is saying, please address the question of loss. Now, Sujit ji, your question is, suppose I have started a business, my turnover is less than 1 crore and there is a loss. So how is it different from the case of Miss C? How is it different from the case of Miss C, which we talked in the last previous slide? In this case also, it was when we said this case, turnover less than 81 crore and net profit is there 4 lakhs. You say it is minus 4 lakhs. So situation remains same. There is no change. When at 4 lakhs also, there is no audit. So how at loss there would be audit? For 44 AD4, I have to first see that have I ever claimed 44 AD earlier or not. Getting, if I have not claimed, then loss, profit, all secondary, na? All secondary. So loss, profit hardly matters. Lots of question comes. There is a salaried person. He is doing F&O. There is a loss. So if there is a loss, the only thing is, am I covered under any of these five clauses? A, B, C, D, E. Am I coming into any of these five clauses? If not, then there is no audit. You need not see anywhere else. You need not see anywhere else. What, Sujit ji, if you claimed, if you, of course, you said that in earlier years you claimed 44 AD. Right? And in this year, of course, both the conditions have to be met now. It is not about the loss of the business. It is about my total income. If I'm having a salary income or FD income, other sources, my total income is more than 2,50,000, audit is required. Both the conditions have to be met. If I have claimed 44 AD earlier and this year my total income is more than 2,50,000, audit would be required. Theek hai Jan sir? Great. So now, going further, so we have discussed about 44 AD. Now let us talk about 44 ADA. Now 44 ADA, if I talk about, up to assessment year 2021, it was allowed to everyone. But this, by this Finance Act 2021, they brought it at par in relation to the eligibility of an SSE to 44 AD, that it would be allowed only to an individual HUF and a firm except LLP. But individual HUF and firm excluding LLP. But when the Finance Act was, Finance Bill was finalized and made an act, an amendment was moved in the Parliament to exclude the HUF. So only an individual and firm can avail of 44 AD, not an HUF, because the government realized that HUF cannot do a profession. He cannot do a profession, which is right. A company cannot do a profession, HUF cannot do a profession. So LLP also excluded. And why LLP is excluded? LLP is excluded, if you read the memorandum, the reason given is because under the LLP Act, you are required to maintain the books of accounts. Is it correct? Yes, it is correct. Now, my one question here. Let us take a case of a company, a private limited company, who is required to maintain books of accounts. Who is required to maintain books of accounts and also get it audited. Can it file its return on presumptive basis? No, everyone says no. So Janya Daduji, your answer to your question is brought forwarding of the loss. There is no audit required. I just said, see these five clauses A, B, C, D, E. If covered there, then only the audit is there. Otherwise, no. So my answer to my question for companies availing of presumptive taxation, everyone says no. I suppose if you see ITR 6, if you see ITR 6, it contains the presumptive taxation in case of 44 AE. So it is there, na, Rajesh ji, it is there, na, for 44AE. So companies having books of accounts, getting the auditors can have to mandatory go for 44AE if they are having less than 10 truck by trucks. Though maintaining books of accounts, getting audited, but still required mandatory 44AE. But LLP excluded because they are maintaining books. So I am not able to understand the reason. I am talking about the reason. They have excluded. Okay, fine. Now, let us take a case. Let us take a case of a, because LLPs were brought in purely initially for the benefit of professionals. So let us, our many chartered accountant friends have converted their firm into LLP. So what is the impact of this? What is the impact of this? So I'm talking about CA LLP, right? CA LLP, one is A CA LLP, second is B CA LLP. Their gross receipts, both gross receipt is 40 lakh rupees. And their expenditure, A says that he doesn't have the complete detail of the expenditure. So he says, okay, 20 lakhs funds flow I've managed. So for 20 lakhs, I'll go for 44AD. B says, I've got the details of all the expenditures. It is 30 lakhs. Why I should pay higher taxes? I'll get it audited under 44ABD. Up to assessment year 2021, this was the situation. But now what happens? LLP is not allowed for 44AD. ADA, not allowed for 44ADA. So B is very happy. B is saying, okay, I've got the details of all 30 lakh rupees. No audit required. My due date remains 31st July. That is no issue. But why I should pay a higher tax? A has an issue. A says, I cannot avail of 44ADA. I have to maintain the detail of all 20 lakhs. So for some, it is a profit. For some, it is not a profit. Right? And one of the very important things that who can avail of 44ADA? Only those professionals who are covered under 44AA1. Not all. Merely your income is, your TDS is deducted under section 194J, you cannot say I am a professional under 44AA1. You should be engaged in the profession under section 44AA1, read with the rule 6F. To all others, 44ADA is not applicable. Not applicable. And in this case, if you are covered, the SSE is covered under 44AA1, read with the rule 6F. And the gross receipt is less than 50 lakhs and profit is 50% or more, then he can avail of 44ADA. And if he doesn't, he is covered under this 44AA1 and he is not declaring his profit 50% or more, then the audit is required under 44ABD. And of course, my funds flow have to be commensurate. So what are these professions which are covered under 44AA1 read with the rule 6F. Just revising. Yes, accountancy, architects, authorized representatives, company secretary, engineers, film artists, actors, cameramen, the whole list is there. Interior decoration, legal, medical, technical consultancy, information technology. Sometimes we miss upon this technical consultancy. Sometimes we miss upon information technology, the persons who are making websites and all those things. Interior decoration sometimes. Accountancy, if I talk about, it is not that the person should be professionally qualified because these film artists, they are not professionally qualified. It is upon the nature of services. So accountancy would be including chartered accountants, cost accountant, part-time accountants. The nature of service should be accountancy. It is not that if I'm a chartered accountant and I'm trading into any goods, so I'll be covered under 44ADA. It is upon the nature of services. Professional degree is not that important. Nature of service is important in mind. Right? Any questions up to this point, please? Any questions up to this point, please? Okay, let's go further. Great. Now, let us talk about this profession in one more slide to understand it. we have, if I talk about profession, we have talked about few sections. One is 44 ADA. One is we have talked about 44 AB, audit is required. Then we are talking about 44 AA, accounts requirement, and the TDS section 194J. So let us see the interplay of these four sections with the profession. You know, it's a bit interesting.
Hello?
It's a bit interesting, right?
Hello?
Yes, sir. If I talk about 44AA, which is there for the maintenance of books of accounts. For maintenance of books of accounts, 44AA, there are 5 to 6 subsections. But we'll be talking about only two subsections, subsection 1 and subsection 2. Subsection 1 talks about my professions, which are mentioned in this section, which you talked about accountancy, medical, right? And which are not mentioned there, they have said as specified in Rule 6F. So these we call as specified profession. We call. It is not given in the Act, but we call them. For this, what is the requirement to maintain books of accounts? The section says, if the gross receipt is exceeding 1.5 lakhs, gross receipts, then the books are required. Even if I am covered under 44 ADA, the section 44 AA subsection 1 doesn't give a relief. So what are the books required? So how I'll comply with the maintenance of books of account and still claim 44 ADA? Because what are books required apart from my doctors, the medical profession, where they say the client registers, they say you have to maintain the cash book, the ledger, the journal if you are maintaining the accrual system of accounting, and the invoices, incoming and outgoing copies. So, okay, in my profession, I can maintain if I'm availing of 44 ADA also. In ledger, what I'll do, I'll put an ledger account in the name of expenditure. Because the purpose of maintaining books of account is to enable the AO to compute the income as per the provisions of the Act. And as per the provisions of the Act, I'm proving through my books of account, through my these funds flow. That's why these four items have been asked several times. My cash balance, my debtors, creditors, inventory, you know. If I'm giving this, then my top line, I'm explaining expenditure this much and I'm proving my funds flow. He's enabled to compute my income as per 44 ADA as per Act. So it is fine. So these are only the specified profession, not others. Subsection 2, it talks about two things. One is business. Second is profession other than 44AA1. So profession is specified here. Here all other profession comes. And here the requirement for books of accounts is, in case of individual HUF, my sales turnover gross receipt is exceeding 25 lakhs or my net profit is more than 2.5 lakhs. In case of others, 10 lakh rupees is my sales gross receipts and 1.2 lakhs is the profit. Sometimes that's why we have received where I have declared a profit of 3 lakh, my total income as 3 lakh rupees from the business and I have not maintained the books of accounts. So 1399 have come because there is a requirement to maintain books of accounts. 44 ADA is applicable only to subsection 1 and not to 2. Not to 2. 44 ADA is only subsection 1. 194J, initially when everything was computerized, so what did CPC do? Any deduction made under 194J? They said, oh, for 44 ADA, you have to declare 50%. It is a profession, all those things. But later on, they corrected it, of course, when they understood. But 194J doesn't talk purely about profession. It talks about profession. It talks about fee for technical services. It talks about royalty. it talks about my director's fee. It talks about my non-compete fee. So many things. One of them is profession. So if I talk only about profession under 194J, 194J again specifies certain professions and further says, or anything notified under section 44AA1. Plus, any other profession notified under 194J. So is there any profession which is notified under 194J and not under 44AA1? Yes, one of them is sports persons. So sports person TDS is deducted under 194J, but they are not covered under 44AA1. So they cannot go for 44ADA. They would be covered under subsection 2 of 44AA1. So interesting they have made. So interesting they have made. And if I talk about audit, 44AB, it talks only about A, business, B, profession. Not taking into account one or two, any profession. Any questions, please? Technical consultant is defined under subsection in section 9. Section 9 talks about fee for technical services, which includes technical services. So technical consultancy would be a part of fee for technical services out there. So tax consultancy is not a technical consultancy. It has to be in the nature of consultancy. No, it is not defined. Again, I have to take from various case laws. Nowhere defined. Exclusion method in 44AD is to commission income and to the person who receives commission income. Can we interpret like this? Is to not commission income. It is to the person who is receiving commission income. So 44AD is not applicable to that person itself. Sujit Jainji, can I file ITR 3 even when I am showing profit more than 6-8%, 50%? Yes, it is not mandatory to avail 44AD. You can show profit loss account, balance sheet, say 80% profit, no issues. Movie director is, of course, a film artist. He is covered into a profession out there. A whole list is there. Another question, exclusion method in 44AD. I've already talked about this. Any other question, please? Okay, great. Now my another question, which is a bit different from this tax audit. There are various compliances. Should the compliances be lower or not? Two cumbersome compliances, should they be lower or not? Sujiji says lower. Raghavendra Kumarji says no. Others view, please. They should be lower or not? Two cumbersome, complex compliances. Views of others, friend, please. Lower needed, easy compliances. Okay. Good. Compliances, of course, sir. My second question out here. The GST audit has gone. Tax audit limit increased from 1 crore to 10 crore. Talks of companies audit going away. Are we happy or not? No. One person says happy. Okay, great. All others says no. The name of that person is not there. It is OPP. So I'm not talking about the name. So we are not happy. You know, why am I talking about this? Because many of us, or a few of us, want lower compliances. So they have lowered the compliances. No tax audit, no GST, no company audit, no TDS returns, know, Sujit ji, are we happy? Compliances are not on chartered accountants. Compliances are on businessmen. Do we understand? Have you ever heard any advocate saying why there are new and new laws, why they are so complicated? Or have you ever heard a doctor saying why so many new diseases are there? But a chartered accountant is saying why more compliances? Why complicated compliances? Do we understand that what all we are doing? Many of us, I'm not talking about those who are into consultancy and growth of business, but mere hardcore practice with the compliances. It is not because of the SSC which we are getting the business. It is purely because of the government. It is not Trivenju Kumarji because the fee is same. It is upon you to charge a fee. If you are not ready to charge a fee, it is your problem, not the government problem. They are giving you the work. You don't want to charge, very happy. Now suppose I'm your customer. I'm your customer. And you don't ask a fee from me. I would be the happiest person. Na? Why should I give you the fee? You are ready to do it. Na? You are afraid because if you ask, I'll shift to someone else. You're afraid of that. Na? I'm taking the benefit of that. Of your fear that I'll go to someone else. So you are working more and more compliances at the same fee. So you are happy. I am also very happy. Please understand, these all compliances, audits, all are due to the government. And we use sometimes the social media in such a way. Criticizing these compliances or the government and asking for the extensions. They say you are overburdened. Chartered accountants are overburdened. So let us reduce the compliances. Give it a thought. This raising of the limit, GST audit, company audit, or other compliances, they are in the process of reducing because we are saying again and again, filing writ petitions, writing on the social media that we are overburdened. So if our burden will reduce, there will be no requirement of us. Please have that thought process in mind. Rajendra Prasad ji is saying medium-sized businessmen are not in position to pay the fee for new compliances. Have we brought it? Has the chartered accountant brought that? Please understand. They are ready to pay the fee if we ask for that. It is in our mind that they are not they cannot afford the fee. It is in our mind. Have we asked? Have they refused? No. Out of fear, we don't ask. We need to be professional. Maintain the integrity. Have a thought process, what I'm trying to say. If the compliances are going to come down, there would be no requirement of chartered accountants. Please think about this. I'm not discussing too deep into this, just a thought process. And why? Because I'm talking about, because this is the reason that, because I had an occasion to meet the Honorable FM and they categorically said that you have been filing the writ petitions, giving the representation letter to extend the dates. So you write so much thing, a few of them write so many things in the Twitter and all those things. So you are overburdened, so let us reduce your compliances, your burden. So let us not ask for any extensions or all those things, because the penalties are not going to happen on us. It is going to happen on the SSC, and we are there to support both the government as well as the SSC. We chartered accountants are helping both the government in the compliances, in making the SSC aware of the laws, and helping the SSC whenever any notice comes. The only thing is charging of the fee, for which we need to understand that no one can tell us how much fee is to be charged. It is upon me. If I am ready to do free of cost, it is very fine. There are various chartered accountants who charge for everything. I've been saying this from umpteen number of years. you know, a thing which has been always said that audit not documented is audit not done. I say that is very fine, but also any service for which you don't charge is not a service rendered at all. I may feel that I have rendered a service, but you ask the client, for what? What fee? What have you done? Because you have not charged. Thought process, think about it. Don't think that other is doing or not doing. Think about yourself, your cost. Now, this limit has been increased from 1 to 5 crore, and now this year it is 10 crore. Assessment year 21-22, the limit for 44 ABA is 10 crores. With the condition that this 10 crore is only if my receipts aggregate in cash does not exceed 5%, and my payments aggregate, the cash portion is not exceeding 5%. A simple example, whether it is a sole proprietorship, partnership, LLP or company, its turnover is 8 crores. Its receipts cash portion is less than 5%. Its payments cash portion is also less than 5%. In this case, the limit is 10 crores. But if any of one increases by 5%, then my limit goes back to 1 crore. Let me ask a very, very, very simple question out here. A very simple question again. I'll come back to this slide after asking the question on the next slide. There is a sole proprietorship. Sole proprietorship. Mr. A is into business. His payments are all by banking channels or by NEFT. He purchases only from one person, so he makes all the payments to RTGS NEFT. His receipts, his sales is 6 crores, out of which 20 lakhs of the sale is in cash. Now this 6%, 5% is 30 lakhs. Only 20 lakhs is in cash. Proprietor and proprietorship is one and the same thing. So proprietor introduces capital which is required, 25 lakhs in cash, and also he takes a loan from his brother, but that 50 lakhs was received by NEFT. So the question is, is tax audit required in this case? Is tax audit required in this case? Again, different views. Some says yes. Venkataji, I have given you the facts. So we've got different views. The answer is, of course, the tax audit is required. I have to see my total receipts, which is 675 lakhs, out of which cash is 45 lakhs. I don't have to see business, personal, the books which I'm auditing. I have to see its receipts and payments. Sometimes I go too much theoretical. I have to see this. I prepare receipt and payment account, which I used to do in my early 11th, 12th or graduation, or even the case of trusts. How do I do it? I've got opening cash and bank balance. Then I put all receipts. So if a proprietor adds a capital, will this not come into receipts in my proprietorship books? Yes, it will come. Is not his drawings which will be going out coming into these payments? These are receipts, these are payments. And then I have to match my closing cash and bank balance. So of this, I have to see 5%. Of this. My another very small question. Another small question. The example which we took, 8 crores is my gross sales. Receipts cash portion is also less than 5%. Payments cash portion is also less than 5%. So technically my limit is 10 crores. Still, can I do the audit? Is this audit mandatory or optional? Can I still do the audit? Can I still do the audit? Is it mandatory or optional? everyone says optional. Right. So majority, everyone says unanimous optional. Revenue Kumar ji, for calculating threshold limit under 44AB. For 44AB, turnover limit is there, 10 crores. So capital introduced loan taken is not turnover.
But they have used the word gross receipts there also.
Sir, gross receipt from business, sir. Gross receipt of business.
Business is also business loan loan, you know, sir.
No, no, no. Gross section, receipt.
Is also under section 44AB. This is also under section 44AB.
No, sir. Please understand. When my 44AB starts, it says in case of a person having a business, so his sales receipts, sales turnover or gross receipt, as the case may be, exceed 1 crore. Right. So, of the business, my capital introduction is not gross receipt of business. Gross receipt is normally taken in the case of services, in the case of profession. Right. Where I take gross receipt, otherwise it is turnover. Gross receipt has to be from the business purely. And it is
turnover we have to take, sir. Turnover and sales. Sales means trader, manufacturer and trading.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Turnover.
Turnover again, which I am turning over my sale considerations. My sales. Sales again. It depends on our turnover. If I say, suppose in my real estate, I put it into a percentage completion method. So I take it as a turnover. So, assessee to assessee, it could be a sale, a turnover, or a gross receipt. Suppose I am into, consultancy services. So, if I am into consultancy services, it would not be my turnover, it would not be my sales, it would be my gross receipt. So, virtually, it is my top line, which I show in my income expenditure or profit loss account. Rajendra Prasad, sir, question is for purpose of 2061H or 194Q, whether GST collected is to be taken or not. Advances will be covered under turnover, in my view, no. Depends upon case to case. There is an old judgment for the turnover where in case of a real estate builder, so everywhere it is not covered, case to case, as the case may be, I have to see. Yes, for 2061H, of course, the GST is to be included because that is on the sale consideration. And 194Q, of course, GST is to be excluded because all TDS, except for all TDS, GST is to be excluded. And this has been again clarified by the CBDT in the recent clarification or the guidelines issued for 194Q and 2061H. Right? So everyone says that in this case, it is optional. Friends, the answer to this is, it is not optional, it is mandatory. We have never read any law which says it is optional to do the audit. It is your wish whether you want to get audited or not. No, either there is an audit as per law or not. So in this case, if you do an audit, in this case, it would not be an audit under 44 ABA. It would not be an audit. Because if you talk about clause 8 of my 3CD, where you feed in the relevant clause and you write it in as 44ABA, and then you say in your 3CB, 3CA, that it is true and correct. So the problem is only on the auditor. Only on the auditor. Because business will say, I'll know, I don't know. My CA told me. So the ICAI would be holding you negligent. The income tax department would be holding you negligent. And the government would be saying chartered accountants are fooling the businessmen because we intended but that below 10 crores, there should be no audit. But they are just fooling them and getting audited. And please see that in this case, because this is not an audit under income tax, my due date doesn't change. My due date remains 31st July. 43B, 40AIA, TDS, 54, 54F benefit, all those due date 31st July. Now there is a question which is asked, that in various cases, the bankers asked for this tax audit because their limit is more than 10 lakhs. And as per the RBI regulations, they wanted audited balance sheets, financial statements. Yes, give it to them, but not everything is not 3CA, 3CB, 3CD. Issue an audit report as per SS 700. Your responsibility is virtually same. They want an audit report. They don't want you 3CA, 3CB, 3CD. If it is not applicable, you cannot give. You cannot give. Issue SS 700. 705, 706. Please understand, it is very, very important. And just when we were talking about this cash portion, if you see the audit information in ITR 3, 5, and 6, in the ITR, there they ask whether during the year total sales gross receipt of the business, sales turnover gross receipt of business exceed 1 crore but does not exceed 10 crore. So if it is between 1 to 10 crore, then you have to say yes. Then it asks whether the aggregate of all amount received, including receipt for sales turnover or gross receipt or capital account such as capital contribution, loan, etc. in cash does not exceed 5%. So ITR also says that capital, etc. all are to be considered for the purpose of computing this 5%, not the turnover. This is in the ITR. This is in the ITR. Again, similarly for payment, repayment of loan and all those things. Now, one more thing out here. Now, this year, in this 44AB, they have done a thing which is very important for assessment year 21-22. 10 crore limit. They have added a provision. And what does that say? It says that in case, the assessee is receiving or paying through checks or drafts, then in case those checks or drafts are not through account pay checks or drafts, then those account pay check or draft would be treated as cash for the purpose of this section. It would be treated as cash for this section. So please understand, in case of receipts or payments which are not through account pay checks or drafts, that would be counted for the purpose of this 5% demand limit goes back to 1 crore. This is very, very important. Please understand. Who is going to decide whether it was account pay or not? In case the assessee is receiving and making the payments through NEFT, RTGS, IMPS, of course, these are not through bank, through check or drafts. So in this case, my limit is 10 crores. But am I receiving and paying through checks or drafts? Who will certify whether it is through account pay or not? If you see your tax audit report since ages, for what we have been writing for 40A3, that though we have not observed any payment to have been made by other than account pay, check or draft exceeding rupees 10,000 rupees per person per day, earlier it was 20,000, now it is 10,000. Yet the assessee did not possess the necessary documents to evidence the same. We have been writing it. It is being copy pasted, so you must have missed it. What will happen in this case? Now, will they have these documents to evidence that it was through account pay? Please understand this very, very careful. This is applicable for this financial year ending March 21. Again, please understand, there are two things I have to check. One is receipts. Second is payment. And please understand, it is purely upon the assessee. If the assessee says that everything is through account pay, check and draft, it is his responsibility. Auditor has no role. And we should encourage that. Why should I certify? Okay, if you are taking responsibility, no problem. Your due date is 31st July. Let us file by 31st July. Let us file by 31st July. No issues. In case any notice comes, we are there to support you. We are not against anyone, neither government nor SSE. We are professionals. We are ready to help each and everyone. We'll support you. We'll prove that it is was through account checking because the call is of the SSE, not of the auditor. Please understand. Now, if the SSE is doubtful, because the call is of the SSE, not of the auditor, in case of payments, he can never say that he has any doubt that it was not through account paycheck or draft. He can never say. Because if he says, then 40A3 comes. So you'll have to say, no, it was through account paycheck or draft. He has issued the checks now. So he cannot issue the draft. But in case of receipts, he can say. If he has a doubt, because many of his clients are depositing in his bank account from outside his location, his situation. So he doesn't know, I don't have a copy. I don't have a copy. Or in case of an entity, there could be an accountant who is sitting outside, who is collecting checks and depositing. So I don't know whether it is account pay or not. The issue is, they have added it this year, though it was not required. But they have added it this year. And please take care of what is account pay. Technically, account pay is in case of a check, if you put two lines, it is not account pay, it is crossed check. Account pay would be if you are writing account pay. Many of our friends are just putting two lines and saying it is account pay. Technically, if I use the words, as per account pay, though practically as per regulations also, even because earlier the cross check could have been endorsed, but to my knowledge, even now the cross checks, they are not getting it endorsed. If it was so, they could have put it cross check also, but they have put account pay in, and they have amended few years back from cross check to account pay in my 40A3 also. So I have to be very careful. So in the case of receipts, if the SSE is doubtful, then he has to again talk about two things. One, in case of his invoices or receipts in a single day exceed 2 lakh rupees, then he'll have to say, I see all those checks. They were all account pay. For below 2 lakhs, he can say that no, these were deposited outside or my accountant, I don't know. And if he gives that to the auditor in writing, then for below 10 crores, he can consider this as cash and then calculate 5%. And if it exceeds 5%, then the auditor would be writing that in his report based upon the certificate which he has received from the SSE. Then his limit would be 1 crore. So interesting, they have made it. I now don't use the word complex. I use interesting. So be very careful. This is applicable from this year onwards. Any questions? Trivenju Kumarji, I could not get your question if amount is not received. Sujit ji, it is not upon us to audit. It is upon the SSE to take a call.
The amount not received means, sir, the sale consideration is not yet realized. So whether sale, we will take it cash or check like that?
No. It hardly matters. It has to be gross receipts, receipt payment account. Receipt payment account, whatever comes. Suppose I have made turnover of 6 crores. I have not received a single penny. In receipt, there would be nil.
Okay.
Loan. It has to be receipt and payment account. Sujit Jainji, again, call of the SSE. Let us understand. We are professionals. SSE will have to take a call. It is upon the SSE and he should not change from year to year. We have to make him understand it is your call. In spite, last year it was 5 crores. So in that case also what we did all the audit. We filed the return though it was no audit report required. So we did not file the audit report, but we did all those things. Yes, this option is to be selected in the ITR. So ITR also, we help them in filing it. But have that in writing in advance. Based upon that, otherwise the auditor would be held guilty. Ashrikanthi, turnover 8 crores, no cash receipt or payment. Loss shown in 44. Sir, why required? Which clause? I just stopped A, B, C, D, E. You tell me under which clause you want to audit. Or you have a question. It might be filing under any of these 5 clauses, A, B, C, D, E. Gopati ji, your question is turnover 90 lakhs. Accounts maintained, NP is 3.5 lakhs. Should he go? You tell me under which clause you will audit. Madhumanabandi, you tell me under which clause you will audit. There is no clause under which you can audit. A, B, C, D, you tell me which clause. Whenever in doubt, just see these 5 clauses. A, B, C, D, that's all. Any other question? Great. So it is becoming more and more interesting, 44 AB audits and all those things, right? So let us go further and talk about one more question. Again, 44 AB AD. And if I talk about ABC and company, it was a partnership firm which was formed in assessment year 2021. And in this year, his turnover was 1.25 crores. And his profit was 10%. Net profit was 10%. As Sujit Jainji says, that he did not avail the 44 AD. He got himself audited under 44 ABA because it was more than 1 crore. He did not avail of 44 ADA, though his profit was more than 10%. Turnover exceeded 1 crore, so he got himself audited. This case finished. Now the question comes in assessment year 21-22. Now in this case, his turnover is again 1.95 crores. It increased, but the net profit is same again, 10%. But his question is here. His question is that now my receipts and payments cash portion is less than 5%. Would there be any audit? Would there be any audit in this case for assessment year 21-22? Your answers, please. Suji Jansi says no. Any other view? Appaya Charanji also says no. Hari Krishnanji also says no. Very right, because now my limit is 10 crores. But he has another question. He says, this is fine. Last year I got myself audited. Now this year, can I avail of 44 AD? Can I avail of 44 AD? Sujitji says yes, Harikshanji says no. All of us maximum are saying yes. Yes, the answer is yes, he can. Because in the first year, he did not avail of 44 AD. Though he could have, but he has not. He got himself audited under 44 ABA. So for assessment year 21-22, he takes 44 AD. For 22-23, he says, okay, I won't take 44 AD. Now starts 44 ABE for 5 years. Is irrespective of his percentage of profit share. This is what is 44 AD for. That once you have to avail of 44 AD. Let us just see this presumptive incomes all, the whole chart, where the profits are less than the deemed profit. 44 AD, business income, if availed of 44 AD and not availed in next 5 years, then audit for 5 years.
which provision says 4484 and 5, audit provision 4480E. In case of profession, less than deemed profit, audit no 5 years condition, every year you have to see. Declare more, if not audit 4484ABD. Goods carriage, declare, if not audit 4487, 4484ABC. Shipping for non-resident 44B, they say no, not allowed. No audit. You have to declare the deeming income only. Similarly, for operation of every crop and non-resident, no audit. You have to declare the deeming income only. For exploration of mineral oils and turnkey power projects, audit is if less than deemed. So, subsection C talks about this 344AE, double B, and B, triple B. D talks about my profession, and E talks about my business. A talks about my total business, 1 crore, 10 crore, and B talks about my profession. This is all 44AB. Let us just summarize that in only one chart, once again, only for 44ABA, audit of businesses, summarizing all what we have discussed. Four limits. One is turnover less than 1 crore. Second, it is between 1 to 2 crore. Third, it is 1 to 10 crore. And fourth, above 10 crores. In case the assessee is turnover above 10 crores, then tax audit is there irrespective of anything, percentage profit, cash, non-cash, whatever you think. In case of individual, HUF or partnership firm, only these three, if their turnover is between 1 to 2 crore and they avail of 44AD, no tax audit. Receipts payments, 100% can be in cash. Nothing to worry about it if they are availing of 44AD. But in case of individual HUF and partnership firm, including LLP and company, if their turnover is between 1 to 10 crore, and these three had not availed of 44AD, then I have to see the receipts and payments. If both are less than 5% cash portion, then the limit is 10 crore. Any one exceeding 5%, the limit is 1 crore. Below 1 crore, only I have to see in the case of my individual HUF and partnership firm. If they have ever availed earlier of 4480, if they have not availed of 4480, forget it. But if they have availed, for example, say for assessment year 1920, their net profit was 10%. They availed of 4480. 2021, they said there was a COVID, profit was 2%. We told them, okay, declare 8%. They say, no, why should I pay tax? Then we said, okay, do the audit. 21, 22, they say, we have recouped. But now my profit is 20%. Give me 4480. My turnover is still less than 2 crore. They say, no, not allowed. Now get it audited for 5 years. This is the whole gambit of my tax audits. For business. Any questions, please? That is your question. Under section 44AD, if assessee not operated for 44AD in the second year and audited in the second year, but in third year he has offered 10%. No, if he has not availed of 44AD earlier, there is no audit now. Irrespective of the year, first year, second year, third year, umpteen number of years, his profit is 10%, turnover is 80 lakhs or 1 crore or whatever it may be. So in that case, he can still keep on filing his ITR with balance sheet and profit loss. Any questions up to this point? Okay, great. Now, if I talk about UDIN, Because when there is a tax audit, there is always a requirement of the UDIN. In case you are issuing 3CA, then you have to issue two UDINs. One for financial statement under the other law which you have audited, and second is for 3CA. But if you are issuing 3CB, only one, and choose the correct clause in clause 8 of 3CD, and it should be same in the UDIN and IT website, because if it is different, it will not accept your UDIN. It will not accept. And what is the date on which it is deemed that you have the not deemed the date on which they accept that the tax audit report has been filed? It is not the date on which the tax auditor files the report. It is the date on which the assessee accepts it. The day of acceptance by the taxpayer is the tax audit date of filing. Please understand this. And of course, UDIN you have to upload within 15 days. But now, to our knowledge, the moment this website stabilizes, prior UDIN would be required. So no concept of backdate. Now, let us talk about tax audit 44AB in a very understanding this section. Because we always think tax audit is 3CD, 44 clauses. One of these clauses is clause 8. It is under which provision you are auditing. We have to issue either of these two reports, 3CB or 3CA. If you are issuing 3CB, then you have to choose any of these five clauses, A, B, C, D, E. But if you are issuing form 3CA, the audit may be due to either of these three, either of these five. But you have to always fill the third provision to section 44A. Not these five clauses. Third provision, you have to choose in this clause 8. Why? And this brings a very crucial point in the tax audit, which we might be missing. What does section 44AB says? 44AB says that in case an assessee is covered in any of these five clauses, then what he has to do? He has to get his books of accounts audited and issue a report, obtain a report from the accountant. First provision says that in case of 44, where the business is under 44AD, then the limit is 2 crores. Second provision says that in case of 44B and 44BBA, there is no turnover limit because they have to file in the deeming provision. Third provision says that in case the assessee is required to get his books audited under any other law, this portion, under any other law, then it would be enough compliance only if this report is issued under this clause. So 44AB talks about two things. We are just talking about this report, 3CD. What about this books audited, true and fair view, either under any other law or under this Income Tax Act? For this, I have to see my accounting standards and standards on auditing. And here we might be missing a lot. Have you ever given any qualification in tax audit related to my true and fair view of the books of accounts? Because it is not merely these 44 clauses. I have to give my true and fair view on the balance sheet and profit loss also in this tax audit. Audit of my financial statements, which is the mandatory basic requirement. These clauses we started with, I suppose, 14 or 15, increased to 30, 31, 32, 40, 44 now. It may increase, it may reduce, but this is not going to change. And this is the reason why various other professionals, like maybe advocates, cost accountant, company secretaries, they say, okay, we also know income tax, we can do the audit, tax audit.
But the government knows that audit of a financial statement requires this accounting standards and auditing, which is not taught in any other course, any other curriculum other than chartered accountancy. Hence, it is with us. And hence my request, please improve the quality of the audit, otherwise it might go away soon. Don't play with facts. As an auditor, I have to give the fact, and I'll support my SSE. I'll be helping the government as well as the SSE. But if there is a wrong fact, only I will be in the trouble. No one else. And work upon this accounting standards and standards and auditing. Any comments, issues? Rajesh ji, if the SSE's turnover crosses 2 crores in the block period enforced for 44AB audit, for the next 5 years, is he prohibited? No, it is not prohibited because he is not opting out. He's not allowed to do it. Huh? If he opts out, then 44AD4 comes into play. Right? Chali, any other question or views? Great. Now, let us talk about the accounting standard disclosures. And here, if I talk about now this year, there are not 3 levels for non-corporates. There are 4 levels. Level 1, 2, 3, and 4. And in my view, this AS1 is very, very important, whether for corporates or non-corporates, because they talks about accounting policies, which we have to disclose at one place. And I've seen at various places that many of these accounting policies we are not mentioning that properly. For example, borrowing cost. Lot of companies are having borrowings from the directors, but there is no disclosure about the policy of borrowing cost. Now, one question. In case of my proprietorships and partnerships, do we prepare notes to the accounts? Do we prepare notes to the accounts? In case of proprietorship and partnerships? Devendra Kumar is saying no. Sujit Jain says yes. Another yes. Okay. So what do we write in these notes to the accounts? Do we write Hari Krishna ji, Ramesh Rajpaili ji is also saying yes. So a few no's. Rajendra Prasad says, which is the appropriate place to mention accounting standards? You know, in the notes to accounts, what do we write in the case of proprietorship partnership? That the firm is following a accrual system of accounting, figures as assets are stated at cost, inventories are valued at lower of cost and neutralizable value. Apart from this, depreciation as per Income Tax Act, apart from this, do we write anything else? In proprietorship partnership, Raviji. Forex. In proprietorship partnership, do we write accounting policies for Forex? Do we disclose related party transactions? Do we disclose the closing balances? No. So is it not mandatory? It's not mandatory. Or deferred tax. Or AS 13, AS 11. In tax audit report, that is 40A2B. Here it is AS 18. Not the tax audit report 3CD, sir. I am talking about accounting standards. You ask where to show it has to be along with my balance sheet profit loss. Notes to account thereof. Are they complying with the AS 10? None of the proprietorship partnerships are complying with AS 10. If they are not complying with accounting standards, are we qualifying our report? are we qualifying a report report? Because none of them are following. They are depreciating as per income tax act WDV. So what type of audit we are doing? We know that accounting standards are mandatory. We know that they are not complying. Still, we are not qualifying. Why? We say because they cannot afford our fees. So if any problem is there, we are going to face. The auditor would be troubled. You know, it is not upon the assessee to comply with the accounting standards in the case of proprietorship, partnership. It is the duty of the auditor to ensure. Ayappaji, it is very rightly said, it is not applicable to proprietorship and partnerships for them to comply, but it is upon the auditors to ensure that when the financial statements are prepared, they are in compliance with the accounting standards. So it is mandatory on the auditors. Auditor have to comply. If not, then you have to qualify. You have no option. The problem is with the auditors, please understand. We are in a profession, and if I talk about our institute, there are two standards. One is accounting standards. Second is standards on auditing, and we have to improve in these two. It is our monopoly. And we all have to improve into that, please. Another question out here. So, accountings, notes to accounts have to be prepared. All accounting standards have to be complied. I'm not going to detail into the accounting standard compliances, but just informing. Are we giving the comparative figures in the case of proprietorship partnerships? Are we giving the comparative figures in the proprietorship partnerships? No. Is it mandatory? Yes, it is mandatory. From where it comes? Another statement, a framework for the presentation of financial statements issued by ICAI. For companies that there is a schedule 3, for others there is no framework. So you have to comply with the framework for the presentation of financial statement issued by ICAI. So what is to be done? Now, it is again not mandatory on the proprietorship partnership. So they are not giving the previous figures. If they are giving, excellent. If they are not giving, what to do? They're not giving, there is no problem to the assessee, but to the auditor, he has to just mention in his auditor's report. Na? Disclosure where? Jain sahab, Sujit ji, disclose where? Where do auditor disclose? He has to disclose that the assessee has not disclosed the previous year figures, which is not in compliance with the framework for the presentation of financial statements. Which audited report? Sujit Jainji, which is the audit report which we give in the case of proprietorship partnership? Do we give SS-700 report in proprietorship partnership? We just give 3CA, 3CB, 3CD. Where is the SS-700 report? Okay, one more question into this notes to the accounts. Do we write that the loans and advances, debt, the creditors, loans, debtors, creditors, loans and advances are subject to confirmation? Do we write debtors, creditors, loans and advances are subject to confirmation? Yes, everyone writes. Yes. So in this case, do we issue in our auditor's report that the financial statements are not true and fair? Do we give a qualification? Do we give an adverse report? It is not true and fair. No, why? You please understand. Notes to the accounts is of the proprietor, the management. It is not of the auditor. Sometimes I get a question that if anything auditor has to say, he should mention it in the notes to accounts. No, notes to accounts is prepared by the management. I've seen various notes to accounts, even in the case of companies where the wording is as if the auditor is writing. It is totally wrong. Balance sheet, profit loss, notes to accounts, all is of the management. Now understand, management is saying, proprietor is saying, my debtors, creditors are all subject to confirmation. I mentioned in the balance sheet that it is 5 crores, but it may be 1 lakh. I'm not sure. auditor is saying he doesn't know, but I know it is true and fair. How that is possible? When the management is saying something negative about itself, how can the auditor say that it is true and fair? Please understand. CCD, there is no place to mention Mukeshwar Rao, sir. But should the assessee mention that these are all subject to confirmation? If everything is subject to confirmation, how a balance sheet can be true and fair? Coaching and verification, I could not understand what you want to say, sir. Management should always write in their notes to the accounts that debtors' loans and advances are stated at the amount at which they are receivable. They have to be positive. If they are negative, I have to issue an adverse report. It might be vouching. Even if it is vouching, management is saying that I am not sure. Nah. Management saying I don't know. While everything is unconfirmed. I don't know what it is. 5 crores, 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 5 crore, 1 crore. I don't know. Everything is unconfirmed. How can auditor say it is true and fair? Please understand. He cannot say. If it is written in the notes to accounts, I have to give a disclaimer. I have to give an adverse report, not disclaimer, adverse. There's a difference between qualification, adverse, and disclaimer. I have to say it is adverse. It is not true and fair because assessee doesn't know. So what is the right way? Right way, assessee should mention in the notes to accounts, my debtors and loans and advances are stated at the amount at which it is receivable. He has to give a positive confirmation. My creditors are stated at the amount at which they are payable. Please understand, this is one of the very, very important points which could come into a problem. And just for your information, there is a change in the AS applicability for non-corporates from 1st April 2020. Earlier, there were three levels, 1, 2, and 3. Now, large, medium, small, and micro. Micro, small, and medium. The limits existing was 1 crore for the small, but turnover and borrowing. It has been, micro has been created less than 10 crore and less than 2 crore of the borrowing. So various exemptions have been given from the accounting standards. Small up to from 10 to 50 crores and borrowing 2 to 10 crores. Medium 50 to 250 crores and borrowing 10 to 50 crores. And more than 250 crores, level 1. Cash flow is applicable, even proprietorship partnerships. Here, no cash flow. AS 18 applicable up to level 1 and 2. Earlier, it was applicable to all. But now, from assessment year, financial year 2021, up to 50 crores, no AS 18. But all other standards, AS 10, they are applicable. They are applicable. So please see which AS is applicable, which is not. Now, we were discussing about where to give the qualification. Because it might be that we have never issued a qualification in the case of a tax audit. Because if I talk about the Form 3CA, there are three paras. This auditor's report is Form 3CA, 3CB. 3CD is a particular which is to be prepared by the management and audited by us, verified by us. Just like balance sheet prepared by management and we have to audit. In 3CA, there are three paragraphs. After examination of the books, I have to give my qualification observation in para 3 only for 3CD. Because on my books, on the true and fair view, I give in my auditor's report, independent auditor's report, which is audited under any other law. Hence, for financial statement, I am not giving in 3CA. I am only giving only for 3CD. Hence, third proviso is required. If I talk about 3CB, there are five paragraphs. And this, our views, our opinion qualification has to be given at two places. For financial statement, para 3A. For 3CD, Para 5. Any observation which you have to give for the financial statements, please use Para 3A. I mean, taxation audit quality report, even for the corporates, I've seen that even 3CA Para 3 is not being used appropriately. Our reporting is in 3CA and 3CB, please. Yes, we have to verify 3CD that it is true and correct. But financial statement for 3CB has to be true and fair. It has to be true and fair. My another question here, and answer, I may be knowing about it, but still am I asking. In this 3CA, 3CB, are we using the SA700, which we have talked a bit today? Are we using SA700? Rajendra sir, you are saying, can auditor mention in 3CD that few of the debtors and creditors subject to confirmation again? 3CD, you cannot write anything. The fixed columns of 44. You cannot mention anything in 3CD. No? They're not asking about debtors. They're not asking about creditors in 3CD. Where you will mention? There is no column for remarks for anything. No? And if they are subject to confirmation in 3CB, if it is subject to confirmation, then you have to qualify. Then the auditor is saying 3CB is of the auditor. If you have a doubt, then it cannot be true and fair. Please understand. Auditor is of the doubt, na? Then how it can be true and fair? It cannot be true and fair. Please understand. Tax audit is not merely these 44 clauses. Financial statement audit is also included for those entities which are not audited under any other law. And here the government really believes on us. And because we are not able to give that real input out there, that's why they are talking that why should we continue with the tax audit? We are not getting appropriate. Everything is nil, 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 nil. 3CA, 3CB is nil, 3CA is nil, 3CD is nil. Not applicable. It is not serving any purpose. We need to improve to save our profession. Please understand. Right. So we are not using SA700. Now, what does my law says? Our institute says. Yes, SA700 is mandatory. But for tax audit, the council has said it is, if you don't give, it is not mandatory. But if I see my tax audit guidance note, which was referred by Rajendra sir also, in tax audit guidance note 2014, it says that it is preferred that SA700 be used in 3CA as well as 3CB. Now, I'm just sharing my next slide certain wordings which should be put in SS in 3CA or 3CB. Now you take a call whether putting that in 3CA, 3CB would be helping the auditor or not. What is to be written? I have amended this as per the SA700 revised and as per the tax audit guidance note issued by ICAI. So I have taken the guidance note and revised as per the revised SA700. So para 3A of 3CB, what does it say? What we should write? We should write the responsibility of the assessee. What is the responsibility of the assessee? His responsibility is for the preparation and fair presentation of the financial statement, which are in accordance with the accounting standards by ICAI. That these are free from material misstatement, whether due to fraud or other responsibilities of the assessee. We are writing in our report and further language. I'm not reading all those. Taken from SA 700, what is the responsibility of the tax auditor? Again, 3A of 3CB, I'll be writing my responsibility in my report. I'm writing is to obtain a reasonable assurance about whether the financial statement as a whole are free from buttery misstatement due to fraud or error. Reasonable assurance is a high level of assurance, but not a guarantee that an audit conducted in accordance with SAS will always detect a material misstatement when it exists. This auditor is writing. Is it not beneficial to the auditor? But please understand, merely writing this will not absolve me from a gross negligence, unless I am able to prove that I have conducted my audit as per the applicable standards in auditing. I have had the proper documentation. And after that, if I write this, then I can say, it is not a guarantee. I have told in my audit report, now read. Of course, if you are not writing, then you are taking a guarantee. It cannot be assumed if you are not writing. So why I should not write about this? I should. Please think again. Do the audit as per the standard auditing, have proper documentation and write this. The wordings I have just amended as per the SA 700. Right. Para 5 of 3CB and para 3 of 3CA. Assessee is responsible for the preparation of the statement of particulars required to be furnished under 44AB. This I have taken from ICAI guidance note, which is a Bible for me and mandatory for a guidance note or mandatory on the members, because that is approved from the council. So on the 3CD, we get it signed by the assessee. He is giving me the particulars. My duty is to, I am responsible for verifying that statement in form 3CD and conducting my audit as per the statement of guidance note issued by ICAI. So should I write this or not? Please take note. Any questions up to this point? Trivindu Kumarji, I just told you as per SA 700, it is to be included in 3CB. I just displayed where and how to put that in my audit report. No separate audit report. It has to be inbuilt into 3CB. Sujayana ji, is a real estate company engaged in building and construction? Is it manufacturing company for the purpose of reporting quantitative? No, it is not. It is not. You know, for this clause 40, if I talk about the ratios, it is applicable only for manufacturing and trading. In the case of service industry, like chartered accountants or others, this clause 40 is not to be filled. My guidance note says so. So not to be filled. Not even for the real estate. Is the party required to sign 3CD? Yes, Rajendra sir. Because he is giving that information. Na? We get it signed from the clients. 3CA, 3CB is ours. 3CD, we get it signed. And even when I was the vice chairman of the direct tax committee, the first year of my council itself, we represented to the CBDT to make the changes in the 3CD to add the signature officially. But they were in the process to amend 3CD, but they have not been able to do that. All qualifications should be in 3CA or 3CB. Yes, it depends upon which audit report you are issuing, 3CA or 3CB. Because you cannot issue both, na, 3CA or 3CB. Either 3CA or 3CB. Again, 3CA, if you are issuing, then your financial statements are audited under any other law. In that case, for financial statements, in that independent auditor's report. In 3CB, if you are issuing, then audit is not under any other law. Then audit is under the Income Tax Act. So here in 3CB, we'll issue for the both. So this is what I, we have discussed in the whole session today. Sujanji, some more qualification which can be given. Please understand that it is not about the qualification, but yes, various disclaimers could be there. Last to last year, I shared a series of my tax audit, which I'll share at the end that where they are, these are available. It is under preparation for this year also, which I'll be sharing, and I'll be uploading on these websites, which I'll be telling you at the later back end of this session. One of that is the exports panel, which Rajendra Prasadji has been contributing a lot into that. So there I would be uploading. So you can join there, or in the tutor also. When I'll upload, I'll share that. So you can download from there. Trivenju Kumarji, is it correct? Printing of client financial statement in chartered accountant letterhead and signing it on audit purpose? Not at all. It is a clear negligence on the part of the auditor, because balance sheet, profit loss and note to accounts are prepared by the management. How it can be on the letter of the chartered accountant? It cannot be. It has to be on the client's letter or on a plain paper. Right? Because these are certain issues which can land into trouble. So that's why we are discussing this. Right? Okay. Great. Any questions? Any questions up to this point? Is provisional financial statement certified by the auditor? Very good question. Banks are asking. You know, if I tell you this is very important. My one question to you. Because I'll be talking about these two things. One, now suppose you have to issue a certificate. A client says, issue me a net worth certificate. Or let me say, he says, issue me a list of shareholders. Certify by the chartered accountant. We want the list of shareholders. So how do we issue that certificate? List of shareholders. What do we write in that certificate? General contents. As per register member, whomsoever it may concern. As observed from this, we are issuing. Are we issuing like this? Whether it is net worth or director list, shareholder list, whatever it may be. No, then how are we issuing Hare Krishna ji another OPP in the name is there. Net worth by seeing the balance sheet, but you're telling about the process. The final product, my certificate, how does it look like? We issue to the client, to the bank. And they say, okay, as observed from the balance sheet, as observed from the financial statement, this is to certify this like this, right? Now, please understand what I'm trying to say. And this is very, very important. For any certificate for that matter. And I'll be coming about provisional financial statements later. But first I'm talking about any certificate, even if it is, because we say bankers ask even for the certified ITR certification. So my view is a bit different. Everyone says that we should not certify. We cannot do a certified true copy. Chartered accountant, when they issue a certificate, it has to be a report. What is he certifying? He cannot do a certified true copy. The notary work he cannot do. but he can issue a report or a certificate. Now, how to do that? I'm telling you the law. As per ICI, the law is, there is a guidance note. Guidance note for the special purpose reports and certificate issued by ICI. Download it from the website. You just type this, you'll get it. It contains a format, a two-page format, which talks about the engagement letter, the agreement. It talks about the accountant's, the assessee's responsibility. It talks about the accountant's responsibility, the chartered accountant responsibility. It talks about the opinion. It talks about the restriction on use. Issue that certificate, any certificate in that format only after obtaining the engagement letter and representation letter. Take UDIN on that and then issue that report. This is the correct way. This is our guidance note, which is mandatory on all members, please. Please download that guidance note, two-page certificate. Charge a fee for that. Anything you issue. Now, coming for this, provisional financial statements. Provisional financial statements, if I talk about, first of all, the auditor cannot do it. Suppose you are its auditor, you cannot do it. If there is any safeguard, we write confirm, instead we certify the certificate issued by us. Krishna ji, please understand that format is as per our institute guidance note. Please understand that format is mandatory for us. We have to issue the certificate only in that format. If institute has issued a format which is mandatory on us, why do we think about anything else? You just read its wording. It is back, you know, anything which is prepared by the institute, it is after huge deliberations. Guidance note, it means it has passed through the council. All 40 members, 32 members, elected, aid, government represented, have gone through that. After that, it has been approved. And it is as per the CA Act, it is mandatory. So why any language, other language? Anything which is beneficial for me, use that only now. Not talking about the provisional financial statement. Let me talk about financial project, provisional financial statement, then I'll take Raviji your question. Provisional financial statement, there is another standard. Standard on related services, SRS 4410. Please note SRS 4410. When I'm talking about SRS 4410, it talks about compilation engagements. Compilation engagements. And it contains a reporting format. I welcome Prasanna, sir. Welcome, Prasanna Garu.
Welcome, welcome, Pramod Jain. Welcome to Andhra Pradesh. Today, I really missed you a lot because I was in some other meeting. It got wrong. 8:30.
You told, sir.
Yeah.
So, friends, sir.
Yeah, please.
First of all, auditor cannot compile the financial statements. So, auditor should not do it, but another CA can do it. So, when the another CA is doing it, he should not use any other way. If I have to sign any document and put a stamp, it has to contain a report. So for the compilation engagement, there is a reporting format given in SRS 4410. After huge discussion, that standard is mandatory. So use that format, which clearly says that the responsibility of the chartered accountant, the auditor who is issuing it, he has not audited. So you need not create your own wordings. The wordings have been given by the council, by that guide, by that SRS standard. Na, use that format and annex that. After taking all your documentations, signed trial, MRL, engagement letter, issue that. Na. Charge a fee. You are getting an opportunity. Why to lose it? Now, suppose even if the client says that issue me a ITR copy, banker is saying, why to say no? Okay, I'll issue. Give me an engagement letter. You draft it. Give me a representation letter. Issue a report, 2-page letter. Then ask, create UDIN, charge a fee, issue it. But it cannot be just a certified true copy, please. Similarly, when you're talking about Raviji, you're talking about the tender documents or the property statements. What are you certifying? Your report has to be in that format and what you are giving an opinion thereon. So give your opinion accordingly. The restricted use that reporting format in that guidance note for the special purpose report certificate. Create UDIN, charge appropriate fee, huge opportunity. Why to say no? Why to say no? If the client is ready to pay the fee, do it. Do it. Net worth statement, same. Issue that as per that guidance note, a 2-page report, and mention in that opinion the net worth is attached, and in that net worth attached issue as per our report dated this with the same UDIN. Get it signed by the SSE, have an MRL. All other procedure for verification you have to do. But reporting format is very, very important. Is very, very important. Right? Who is responsible to prepare 3CD, sir? Whether SSE or auditor, the details are to be given by the SSE. And we have to verify it. Mukteshwar Raoji, I just displayed to you what is given in our guidance note. SA 700 wordings, which clearly says it is the responsibility of the SSE. My report is 3CA and 3CB. That's how I get it signed by the SSE. Any questions on this, please? Now, if turnover is LLP 50 lakhs, then audit under LLP is mandatory, but not under Income Tax Act. Then which clause is to be selected in 3CD? Arre sir, so Yajnathji, in this case, there is no tax audit. There is no tax audit. In this case, it would be SA 700 report. We have discussed this. No tax audit. No audit under Income Tax Act. Only under the LLP Act, SA 700 independent auditors report, that's all. No clause to be selected, no 3CD, please. Everything is not 3CA, 3CB. Everything is not 3CA, 3CB, 3CD. Only if you get in those five clauses, only then a 3CA, 3CB, 3CD would be there. Otherwise, not. LLP now it is out. Then LLP no, he is not referring to that. He is not referring to that quota rouser because LLP's 44AD is not applicable. Now even 44AD is not applicable. Client DSC we are using, is there any declaration to be obtained? Hare Krishna ji, a very important point. First of all, always take care that we are not using. We are never using it. We are facilitating the SSE. He is coming and we are just keeping it for him. Then when he is coming, he is putting. We are not putting. Our words have to be very, very clear what we want to say. Take a declaration that he is kept at our office so that whenever it is required, he can put and use it. We are all professional chartered accountants. We have to be very careful in our language. Proprietor or partnership running a hospital, whether 44AD or ADA, if it is a hospital, it is a business, 44AD. If it is a clinic, one or two doctors coming together, one or two facilities, it is a profession. Depends, case to case. Even a hospital can be run by a non-professional. A chartered accountant can start a hospital. It is a business. Right. So our time is really very short because
I will not be covering the other clauses of PCD. If you have any questions, we can take it. The only thing is that we have got our Prasanna ji as well as China Mastan ji. So I'll be stopping sharing with last one or two slides. Can we certify stock statement based on stock audit report issued by other? Please understand, if the other has given a stock audit report, then why? What we have to certify? Whatever you have to do, what I've said, guidance note for the special purpose, certificates and reports. Read that 2-page download, keep that as a Bible. Keep, I have to use it according to that only. I issue only as per that any certificate. Right. Friends, just sharing one or two slides, then I'll close. This is which one of the questions was asked regarding this real estate class 40 turnover gross profit ratio. It is only for manufacturing or trading activities. Real estate is not a trading activity. And this is the portal which Rajinder Kumarji just talked in the initial, where he's a regular contributor. Export, it is S.in. Here you can sign up. Sign up for free. Once you sign up, you'll get an email ID, where you'll get a link. When you click to that, your account gets activated. And thereafter, you can just log in and ask any question on any subject, GST, income tax, capital, or RBI, FMR. Lots of there. And the answer would be coming to your email ID as well. It would remain here. You can see here also. Existing questions also, you can search questions, articles, experts. Just put here search, you'll come down. Various articles, presentations, videos, notifications, category wise. You click here, click on the category. Relevant would be coming. As told by in the initial things, that now more than 28,000 answers have been given by more than 115 experts throughout the country. So anyone can use it. There's a mobile app also. In the app, these features are not there, but question answer you can ask and see. For this, you have to go to this portal. And another website where I'll be uploading this presentation. It is available on this website as well. It's free mobile app, Lunavat. And here also you can have ready to use charts, like from whom you can take tax-free gifts. Dada, Chacha, Nana, Mama, we have put it like that. Cost inflation index, TDS, TCS dates. It is all updated, not only income tax, but company law and other laws also, accounting standards and others. So you can use all these. Since 2007, it is there. And again, I thank Rajinder Kumarji and all the three branches, Rajinderji and all the three branches for giving me an opportunity to share my views. And in this tough times, please stay safe, healthy and happy and remain positive. Positivity is the key to the success. And I'm available on the Twitter and LinkedIn and other places. You can join me out there. And again, thank and I welcome my very dear friend, Prasanna Kumarji. Who has been able to come join. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Excellent.
Excellent.
Prasanna Kumar, sir. Welcome, sir, for the meeting.
Very good evening, sir.
Speech course, Hyderu Dostanam, sir.
Are you a sir?
Truly, sir. Truly.
Yeah. Respected CA Rajendra Prasad, the chairman of Ongole branch, and CA Srinivasrao, the chairman of Guntur branch, and CA Sujit Kumar Jain, Nellore branch chairman, and most respected CA Pramod Jain, Central Council member and speaker of today's session, CA Chinnamastan, my dear participants. So, good evening to all of you. So, it is my proud privilege, as always, to participate in an event organized by any branch in Andhra Pradesh, particularly Guntur branch and Nellore branch and Ongole branch, one of the most active branches in Andhra Pradesh. The friends, actually today, the hero of the entire session is CA Pramod Jain. Pramod Jain, See, though his age was too junior to me, I am too senior to be age-wise, but knowledge-wise, the exemplary knowledge he has got. I always tell him, so he's the knowledge bank as far as the Central Council is concerned. I don't see any, there may be experts in one subject, but he's an expert in many subjects. So not only income tax matter, direct tax matter, and international taxation, and also, you know, accounting standard, AAAS, anything you take, he has got enormous knowledge. He contributes a lot to the Central Council, and his legal drafting skills, as always, is very good. So in the act and rules, you know, I think the very first year, you know, a lot of amendments were there to the regulations, chart of regulations. He was there. He's a key person who has done the entire job. That, from that day on, I became his fan. Till then, I didn't know who he was. I became his fan. So such a nice person. He's the expert panel. So, you know, that expert panel, even my office is using that. Even my partners also, whenever they get a doubt, I tell them, you please write to them, you'll get a good answer from them. Such a great service they are doing. I request all of you to join there, the experts panel, so that you know, you'll get the instant answers from them. And the one budget publication, my dear friends, there's a budget publication released by Lonavath & Co. It's the chartered accountant firm, where is the partner. So it's a very good publication. There's a lot of demand in Vishakhapatnam. I take some 2-3 copies from him. My partners themselves ask. So next time I take the liberty of requesting Pramod Jain to release a soft copy of that, so that it can go to the entire fraternity. Why only Prasanna Kumar should get the benefit? All everyone should get it. Soft copy can be released next budget. This one, very good analysis they make. Thank you, Pramod Jain, for joining this team in Andhra Pradesh. And you know, now in southern quarters, you have become so famous. So.
Sir, it is all your love and regard, sir. You are so my elder brother, so you have been always very cooperative. And I really congratulate each and every member present here who were earlier also for sending such a nice person in our Central Council. Because I just told that he's sacrificed his the non-standing committees. He's into the standing committee for all the 3 years, examination, finance and executive. So exemplary, sir, exemplary. And even for the last 2 years, he is the chairperson, presiding officer of the Board of Discipline. Sir, hats off to you. Tremendous.
So, thank you, Prabhu Ji. Actually, I might speak to you tomorrow, because two more requests have come from southern region, some branches, large program. They're having national conferences. So I request you to spare time. Anyway, I'll speak to you tomorrow with more details. So thank you very much. So, dear friends, I understand you had a very lovely session today by hearing him. And you are talking about you know, provisional statement, how to certify SRs, all those things. It's a great help to all of us. Thank you very much. Chairman, I'll not take time today. Anyway, tomorrow we're having a program. So, you know, on the multi-panel, multi-purpose empanelment form. So, that time, I'll take some time out of that and speak. This is not the time, already 8:55. So I think we're everyone is waiting for to have food and then retire for the day.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Chairman, you can proceed with your proceedings.
Now, I request Chinnamasthan Garu to say a few words about this August gathering.
Yeah.
Yes. Good evening, everyone.
Chinnamasthan, endu delay avvadu cheppal nu?
Why? Yes, sir. I'll explain, sir. yes, sir. Respected chief guest and our Central Council member, Prasanna Kumar Garu. I can say that another vibrant speaker in tax audit across the Pan India, CA Pramod Ji, CCM and Chairman of Taxation Audits Review Board, ICA. And statements and the office bearers of Guntur, Ongole and Nellore branches, my dear members who joined this virtual program on various aspects of tax audit and related issues. Members, this is the one program which gives and needs applause. It's organized by three branches, that is Guntur, Ongole and Nellore. That too, such a wonderful, vibrant speakers having high clarity in the tax audit. And this different classes in the tax credit. I can say that in different way, wherever I get that calls from the south branches, first they propose the name, the tax audit, the Pramod Jain. Sir, do you have the contact number of the Pramod Jain, sir? Sir, can you speak? Or first you can ask him, sir. Because few of the members in writing sent the branch, the Pramod Jain. We attended his speech in different form. So we request him, sir. Like that, he is the chairman and office bearers proposing his name. Then immediately I put a vote with the Prasanna sir in Hyderabad and Daya sir. Like that, then we are getting the Pramod sir permission to hear his expert knowledge. So that is the credibility in the South, sir, across the South branches and South members. Thank you, sir. And members coming due to some of the preoccupied meeting on MEF issues at Telangana, we could not able to attend program at the beginning. Members, I request for the same program will be conducted tomorrow 5 p.m. to all the members of the AP. The SRC has already sent the mail today and yesterday for joining link to discuss that upcoming MEF applications and the existing RBI norms. So we can interactively discuss. We have that elaborated time tomorrow. So we can consolidate. SRC is sending one Google form. You need to give the feedback. I request every member and post that link, all the WhatsApp groups where the respective branches, so that many participants get that clarity on all the MEF issues. So that's the hands of all the office bearers to get the good gathering tomorrow. And I believe those issues are covered here. And I wish each one of you attended this session, and the best to the branch team for conducting this kind of the programs. And my special thanks to Pramod ji for spending the time with all the three branch members. Thank you. Thank you all for giving this opportunity.
Thank you. Now over to moderator.
Thank you, sir. In the chat box, we have shared the link for today's attendance. So members who have attended the meeting, they can give their attendance in this Google form. Anyone wants to speak, sir? We'll be closing the meeting. Okay, thank you. Now I request our Gundu branch chairman, Srinivasra Garu, to present the vote of thanks. After that, there will be Janaganamana also.
Good evening, one and all. I am very much thankful for giving me this opportunity to express gratitude to this special day. Yes, I can say that today's seminar is a grand success with more than 200 participants on webinar. On behalf of the Guntur and Ongole Nellore, I express my heartfelt thanks to the chief guest, CA D. Prasanna Kumar sir, the CCM, for gracing the occasion in spite of his busy schedule with his various positions in ICI. And I extend my heartfelt thanks to the today's speaker, eminent faculty, CA Praveen Jain sir, for emanating, enlightening the members with excellent interactive sessions, and thanks for the sparing of his valuable time in disseminating his knowledge. Thank you, sir. And I also extend my sincere thanks to the today's guest of honor, Talakala Chinnamasthan garu, Vice Chairman of SIRC of ICI, and RCM of Ongole branch, and CA R. Chengalreddy sir, our good friend of RCM of Guntur branch, for their participation and their valuable words addressing this August gathering. Thank you, sir. And I also extend my heartfelt thanks to all the management committee of the members of the Guntur, Nellore and Ongole branches, and their respective branch staff also. And last but not the least, a sincere thanks to all the participants of this seminar by making the seminar a grand success with your wonderful interaction with the speaker. And thanks for the Ongole branch for inviting us to this seminar. And thank you very much to my good friend, Rajendra Kumar sir, Rajendra Kumar, Jai Hind, Jai Sri. Thank you. Go to moderator.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I request the Baisan Jagamohan Rao garu to play the Janagana Mana.
जनगणमण अधिनायक जय हे गुजरात मराठ द्राविड उत्कल वंग
विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा
उच्चल जल तरंग तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष माहे गाहे तव जय गादा जनगण मंगलदायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
जय हिंद जय आईसीआई
Thanks to all. Thanks to all, Rajendra Prasad ji, my dear friend Prasanna ji, Chinna Mastan ji, Chengal Reddy ji, and all the three branch chairmen and all the participants for making it very interactive. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Pramod ji. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Yes, caller, sir. జన్మస్థాన్ గారు రేపు రిజిస్టర్ చేసుకోవాలా?
అవసరం లేదు సార్,
డైరెక్ట్
లాగిన్ అవ్వచ్చు.
ఓకే,
అందరికి షేర్.